Hi, and welcome to my workshop. My name is Jeroen, and in this video I'm going to tell you a little bit about spherical radius grinding. Now, spherical radius grinding is not a very common technique in the machining of, for example, metals. However, there's one field where spherical radius grinding is very common, and that's in the production of optics. So all the spherical surfaces that you find, for example, on lenses or mirrors, are initially generated using spherical radius grinding. For example, with a machine like this one. This machine is a Loh Spheromatic CNC, and later in this video I'm going to show you around the machine and show you how it works. But first, some more information on radius grinding in general. Now, as I said, spherical radius grinding is not very often used in the machining of metal parts. However, because it's easier to demonstrate, I want to explain the principle by using a standard mill and an aluminum rod. So what I'm going to do is mill a spherical surface on the end of the rod. In this example, I use a milling bit that I normally use for flattening larger areas. And this tool removes material in a circular pattern. Now, for spherical radius grinding, the axis of the mill is actually not placed in the vertical position, but under an angle. And in addition, the aluminum rod that we're going to machine is attached to a rotation table. Here you see how a concave spherical surface is generated. While the aluminum rod is rotating on the table, the mill is gradually driven downwards into the surface. And because the starting position of the mill in this example is in the center of the rod, the milling gradually expands to the outer perimeter of the surface. The end result of the action is a spherical surface with a large radius. I estimate around 200 millimeters. It is rather rough, so by sanding it down a bit, we can quickly improve the surface quality. So here's the result, a shiny concave spherical surface. The Loh Spheromatic machine is intended purely for machining glass and ceramics. For these materials, we need a different type of tooling, which is a cup-shaped diamond tool. The edge of the tool contains small diamonds that are embedded in a metal matrix. Because diamond is much harder than glass, glass can easily be ground away with this type of tool. The angle of the tool and the position of the tool with respect to the center of the glass disc determines whether the shape of the surface will be concave or convex. If the point of first contact is at the center of the disc, we end up with a concave surface, but if the first point of contact is at the edge of the disc, a convex surface is generated. The angle of the tool and the diameter of the cup determine the resulting radius, and the larger the angle of the tool, the smaller the radius of curvature in the surface of the object. When using diamond tooling, the whole process is done using plenty of cooling water, which is necessary to prevent the burning of the diamonds and the damaging of the tool and object. Therefore, the tools generally have a hollow shaft to allow the flow of water through the tool. And in this way, the cooling is not only very effective, but the water also transports the glass particles away from the tool. In general, the larger the diamonds embedded in the tool, the faster the removal rate of glass. However, there is a drawback using very rough diamond tools. The diamonds do their work by generating deep cracks into the material, and the bigger the diamonds, the deeper the damage into the material. This is called subsurface damage. Later in the process, when we want to make an optical surface, we have to perform fine grinding and polishing, and at the end of the process, we have to be sure that all the cracks in the surface, even the deepest ones, are completely removed from the material. So the larger the diamonds, the deeper the subsurface damage, and the longer it will take to remove it. Therefore, there's always a trade-off between high processing speed and minimizing subsurface damage when choosing a specific diamond tool. As for the history of the Loh, the machine was produced in Germany in 1993. Originally for the Dutch Ministry of Defense. I found some of the original purchasing documents of this machine. I myself bought it at an auction, I think in 2016, for around 750 euros, which I consider really cheap. Everything's still working, even after 26 years, including the computer and the green monochrome screen. The machine contains very large bearings, which are extremely solid.
In addition, all the movements are controlled using hydraulics. Here you see a schematic of the degrees of freedom in the machine. The milling axis can rotate, and this rotation is fully controlled by two hydraulic pistons. Here I opened up the back side of the machine, exposing the hydraulic system of the rotation. The pistons drive a chain around the rotation axis. At this end of the axis, there's also an optical encoder mounted to measure the position. The two other axes are also controlled using hydraulic pistons. One piston moves a stage along a rail, which I refer to as the X direction. This movement is basically used to switch between the position required for concave and convex milling. The second piston is used to move the rotating stage up and down, which I call the Z axis in this figure. Now, contrary to the rotation axis, the X and Z axis appear to have only one hydraulic piston, which is counteracted by a spring load piston driven by pneumatics or pressurized air. The Z axis piston is actually hollow and contains a bearing for the rotation of the object table. So, why use hydraulics in this type of machine? It sounds rather unpractical and complex. Well, the reason is that by using hydraulics, one can maintain a very high stiffness in the moving parts while still allowing them to move very accurately. Let me just explain this a bit more by using an example. Here I calculated the stiffness of an hydraulic cylinder of 5 cm length and 8 square centimeters surface. Basically, the stiffness arises from the very low compressibility of the hydraulic oil. If we consider the bulk elasticity of hydraulic oil, which is 1.5 billion newton per square meter, we can calculate that the unidirectional stiffness of a cylinder has a value of 24 million newton per meter. So even moving the piston only 1 micron to the left requires a force of 24 newtons, which is a very impressive stiffness. So let's demonstrate the capabilities of the machine by making a 40 millimeter diameter mirror with a radius of curvature of 400 millimeters. I chose this curvature because I actually need this mirror for another project. The tool and the glass blank are preheated in hot water, and then the blocking wax is melted on the preheated parts. And because of the preheating, the blocking wax remains moldable for some time. Now the next step is centering the two parts with respect to each other. I start out by centering the glass tool with respect to the center of rotation of a small rotation table. And then I try to minimize the wobble in the movement of the carrier tool using a microscope. When I'm satisfied with the result, I do the same thing for the glass blank. And if both are centered with respect to the rotation of the table, they're also centered with respect to each other. After this, the tool and the blank are slowly cooled down to room temperature, and this is to let the blocking wax solidify and in this way fix the position. The carrier disc with the blank is then fixed inside the machine. Next, we need to set several parameters in the machine, such as, for example, the required radius, the object diameter, and the total height of the tool plus blank. If everything's set to the right values, we can do a final check of the process in the advanced high-resolution simulation mode. It shows an outline of the milling process and the position of the tool with respect to the rotation axis. If we're satisfied with the results, we can then start the radius milling process. It is possible to pause the machining at any moment and to check if everything's going well. Here you see that the tool is actually in the right position to generate a concave shape. After a few minutes, the cycle is finished. In the last stage of the process, the removal rate of the glass is actually slowed down significantly in order to improve the accuracy of the end result and the smoothness of the surface. So, this is what comes out of the machine. Notice the rough and sharp edge. We will now first deblock the blank from the support tool by heating up the blocking wax. Next step is to remove the rough edges on the blank by using a diamond sponge and water. So, this is the resulting blank, and is now ready for fine grinding. In order to do the grinding, we need a convex counter tool for this blank. And this counter tool is actually made in an identical manner, just with the opposite surface radius. Here you see the convex shaped counter tool. I left it attached to the supporting glass tool for easy handling. If we place the concave blank on the convex tool surface, you can see that the tool fit quite nicely. Next is to remove all the subsurface damage from the diamond tooling by using fine grinding with silicon carbide. However, this process will be the subject for another video.
Okay, that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. See you in the next one.
Bye.